third time.
Yeah, they like this matchup here. I definitely still think EDG are correct in taking this matchup again. Again, early priority on the Lucian. I mean, they've gotten so much out of Viper in a lot of these scenarios. Hasn't been enough to actually win the game, though. So much has pivoted on the mid jungle champions here. And since they did not pick up a BDD champ, I expect EDG to ban them through here. Are you going to ban away the Zoe? Are you going to ban away the Azir? They don't. They're letting BDD still have at least one of them.
Yeah, I mean, I hope to see the last man be the Zoe, because again, BDD is just way too good on that champion. On the opposite side, though, all the picks with agency that Scout can pick are now gone with the ban of the Ryze, and even going to take away the Orianna for comfort. So Scout going to need to go down into the depths of his pool. And for Gen.G, you would assume they're going to fourth pick jungle, which means they're going to save counter pick for BDD. And there's not really a lot of good options to blind, unless EDG themselves just want to say, hey, screw it, we're going to take an Azir.
Yeah, I mean, his Victor looked okay in the previous game. So you might, you've had a Lulu for a bit of backup, but that is not a heavy frontline. Kennen has five great targets to look at.
Yeah, there's just so much pressure on Flandre's shoulders here. In the moment of truth, you know, finally making that change in champ select, the name and lights with the big Kennen ultimates. So often at Worlds, we have had these memorable Kennen ultimates that just stick with you forever. He's gonna be looking to cosplay Smeb here.
Yeah, I feel like a big difference also coming out of this game is not only in the top side, right, but also in mid jungle. Because it feels like every game is where the side of Gen.G have had prio and pressure in mid jungle, especially in that skirmishing department. This will be the first time where EDG themselves actually have that and will be the ones who can dictate more early game options. So whether that's trying to set up a Smeb-like performance coming out from Flandre, or just going back to the fact that, hey, Viper, despite some mistakes, has had an amazing series, let's keep funneling on the spot side. It feels like this early game is where EDG are gonna have to step up. If not, Gen.G are gonna be able to clinch out the series.
Yeah, and it would be Gen.G's fourth World Championship Final. Samsung White, Samsung Galaxy, Samsung Galaxy. You buy the company, you rebrand to Gen.G, and number four would be this one around.
And Ruler himself was on that Samsung team.
Yeah.
World champion, the only world champion in this game.
It'd be his third final with a new roster around him for the last 2 years, 2020 and onwards. And let's see what comes out of this one. Jiejie faking as though he puts the deep ward down. Of course, you can never verify that. So may force an early sweep out of Clid and won't see anything for it.
Yeah, and looks like once again, potentially might see jungler's path down towards bot side. I feel like we've seen that pretty much every game this series is like we hit on before. Who can impact that bot lane first has really been what has been strong. But Gen.G instead actually looking for an invade.
All right, Scout going to be on the back foot. Should, I believe, just see that Trinket Ward. Spots, yep, puts the ping down for the vision. Sweeper not available, though, and we'll see what Gen.G wants to do with their early game.
Yeah, the jungle tracking from Gen.G in the previous game made such a big difference. Because, you know, the opening game where they weren't expecting the
the gank from Jarvan. They got the early kill in the bottom side, and then Viper and Meiko just pushed that to the limits, getting such a big lead. That was the one win for EDG. So Gen.G since then have accommodated. They've gotten these early deep wards, tracking jungle early on, trying to make sure that that is a non-factor.
I have partial info. It is a pause on EDG's side, which if you've been following the pause analysis so far...
Spilled water break.
So I have not heard what it is. I don't know if it's water. I don't know what's going on. But all I'm saying is in two out of three games, the team that paused lost. So the odds are stacked against the last hope of the LPL.
How long have we been trying to get sippy cups for the players out there?
So they actually have them, I think. Like, almost all of them have, like, a
oh, my goodness.
We've
got the technology, and it still happens.
I mean, the pause would be much longer if it wasn't a sippy cup, and you just, you know, flooded with a quarter gallon or, you know, several hundred milliliters for the Europeans out there.
Yeah.
And also every other continent.
That was a bit rough, like cutting yourself with safety scissors. But still, pretty sad a statistic of the team that paused has lost. Mm-hmm. And I think going back to Gen.G, they've had a really weird few years since winning Worlds of Samsung Galaxy, right? Won Worlds 2017. 2018, they lost in groups. 2019, they didn't even make it to Worlds. And then 2020, they made it to quarters. So it's like a really weird scaling journey that they're making. And hey, with that trajectory, I feel like at least within the next 3 years, they're bound to win Worlds.
They're bound to. It's absolutely guaranteed to happen. I believe it. I'm taking your word for it and giving it no further thought.
I mean, they are the only other organization besides T1 that have the multiple titles under their belts. And yeah, the name change came in. It's a bigger name change, but still there. And they're definitely looking back. Everybody staring at what's on your screen, the Summoner's Cup means everything. They're going to have to put in a lot of practice, too, right now, because Dom1 are looking fearsome, and them waiting, hovering over everybody is going to be a very tall task. In saying that, you have to focus at the task at hand. This game, one game at a time, especially for EDG, who are facing elimination match, just focus on this single game, get your victory, then you can make your adaptations, try and make the comeback in this series.
Yeah, and speaking on this game specifically, since we do have picks and bans up again, a lot of it to me feels like about the early game, a lot of coming out of mid-jungle for the side of EDG, to where when I look at the side of Gen.G, I feel like the Lulu is going to do so well against a comp that is pretty much just all burst for the side of EDG. Emperor's Divide coming out from BDD will do so much against these short-range champions coming out from EDG. I really like the composition that Gen.G been able to put together.
Yeah, there are some big things to keep in mind is marking the Kennen, watching and clearing for those flank wards, and then, of course, the exhaust timing. All of these things. You know, the Lulu polymorph is going to be big. Exhaust timer is extremely big, too, enforcing those. And we've seen so many teams fall prey to it so far at this tournament.
I feel like we've seen both teams as well fall prey to things like flanks that they didn't expect, flanks that they weren't marking coming. Again, that is what decided
the last game.
Rascal, after having a pretty rough game overall, despite the fact that they were in the lead, finds the game-winning play off of one flank. So definitely feels like it's a game of who, not only who can make less mistakes, but who can make the mistake at a less critical moment rather than at 40 minutes in the game.
But I mean, it's also the big play at the end, right? Like, Clid has been absurdly good at the spites. And sometimes you actually just cannot keep Elise out of the pit, and he lands it better. I mean, that TP flank play, like, that's just a very, very good play that wins games. Like, I do want to, you know, give the other side of the coin where it's like, there are really big plays that, hey, that causes the win.
Yeah, I think that the accolades that both BDD and Clid have gotten so far at this tournament, everyone just talking about us, these individual plays have been so big, I think is completely true, especially for some of these specific Zoe plays from BDD, Clid on the Lee Sin, and over, they have really found them.
Yeah, and that's why, you know, if Gen.G are able to take the win and go through, that's going to be another really exciting matchup to come, right? Even though you get it all year long in the LCK, seeing BDD in this form, as well as Clid go up against Canyon and Showmaker right now would be absolutely monstrous. And hopefully for Gen.G, BDD can keep up these performances because, again, you don't know where they can surprise you.
I mean, that's what it comes down to is what level are you playing at what point in your career? Both Clid and BDD have two LCK championships. You know, Clid winning two on T1 back a couple years ago. Cool, well done there. Two back-to-back splits for BDD as well on his King's Own Longju days as that rebrand came through. And then it's like, okay, it's kind of been a drought for both those players, right? And everyone else, it's kind of no regional titles. Obviously, yes, Ruler's made his two world finals. He's obviously had really high points in his own career, but it's everyone kind of coming back together, back to that level. Yes, you can win before, but we're all playing at this level at the same time.
Meanwhile, EDG, they've got loads of regional titles, Lyric. Yeah.
Yet it is all the way back to the first MSI in 2015 that you have to reach for an international title. And you know it means so much to this organization. Since we've got story time here,
yeah.
Remember the last time that we were in China, visiting EDG at the compound. In the waiting room, they've got this video playing that is a compilation, basically, of their win in MSI. And, has been playing for years and years and years. They're so proud of it because international wins are so rare and so prestigious in League of Legends. This team would like nothing more than to get the organization another one. And Worlds, obviously, so much bigger than MSI and having so much weight to it. They're in uncharted territory already for the organization here, just being in semifinals.
I feel like especially this year, right? Well, when they've invested so much into this roster, of like bringing over Flandre, who spent years on Snake Esports and LNG, bringing over Viper from the LCK after being such a stud in his own region. And then again, they've done so well in both splits. They picked up a summer championship, but once again, they're going to have to pull deeper to be able to make it further here today. But like Freak mentioned earlier, we did see it in their last series.
Yeah, I really like that you point out Viper because him being added to this team has had such a big impact just as an individual player. And you remember back to the Hero of Felios play, flashing in and getting them here. Nobody expected them to beat FPX in the finals,
I know. I predicted against them as well in that final.
All right. I can quickly switch over to what's going on our screen as the game is paused. EDG requested some lighting changes, though, to my knowledge, nothing has changed since the first game, but we are making some small changes. And so once that's taken care of, everyone's okay, we are going to get back into this game. So, hey, not water caused. All right. Maybe that's going to change things around. And we are, in fact, back out of the rift. And yes, indeed. Jiejie outsmarted Clid. He faked the ward. Sweeper comes down. He's like, wait a second. There was no ward.
I've been had. Where's my ward bunny? My early experience for Rascal as well. Not going to get it. He is going to get the leash from his top laner, though. So Graves actually going to go late to the lane. Not going to get the early push onto Kennen. And it's going to be the accelerated start there for Clid, trying to get Viego through the early quick first clear, headed towards bottom side. Every second does count.
And yet, Bone Plating and Guardian block a lot of the damage, and it's once again, every single game, Lulu MF just has the better level one, and EDG down in health. They are the ones with healing. You can kind of trade low and then burn mana to get back up, but right now, it's Gen.G with control of the lane.
I want to see if they actually make use of the leash that Clid got. That second is going to mean he gets over there really quick. He went red into Raptors. He can do this super early move towards bottom. When you're building up the wave like this, if you see Ruler and Life now, slow pushing and just last hitting and waiting for the minions to build up to try and crash, then they could draw him down after Cromp. It'd be a quick three, but I think the time is running out and they've already got a ward over Tri-Brush, so that play's not gonna be there. They're gonna try and crash it instead and probably bounce back, but it is still gonna be Clid hovering around bottom side and looking for that bottom crab. With the bottom pushing, you have the early move.
Nice aggressive trade in the top side. Now don't forget to grab your exclusive Happiness Overload Prime Gaming emote so you can flex in your next game. Maybe you get a bear, maybe you get an ace. I don't know, put it on all five slots, who cares?
Well, I mean, looks extremely cute, I'd want it, but Clid going in. Scout can follow up.
Yeah, it's a, a Spell Thief. Shirelia is not gonna matter too much, they're still fighting over these. Smite is up for both junglers. You put it in the brush, you can kind of take the advantage. It looks like it's still going to be with the wave pushed in. Oh, that level could mean a lot. Yeah, they can find the knockup if the spells are back available. Find at least an auto attack going in for Clid. Here's it going to be enough as it's Azir coming in, the Emperor, and the first kill comes in. And now JJ going to fight for a bit more, does trade it back. Is it going to be enough? He's channeling the teleport away. He's going to go to sleep. Scout makes his double kill happen.
And this is what you need when you bring out the Zoe and the Jarvan for yourself to be able to take these early game skirmishes. Scout, the MVP of LPL Finals with a 2-0 lead in this game.
Oh my god, where do we start with it, Lyric? That one was hilarious. The Raptor fight here in the elimination match with the teleport right in front of his face.
I mean, hey, Gen.G can make those sort of plays because they don't have their back against the wall with that pressure. Hey, if we lose, we're out. We're going to go straight to the replay. Bumble does come down after an extended posturing over those Raptors. Jiejie holding on to the EQ. Not actually sure if it was even up at
the pretty sure his Q was just used in the Raptor fight there. Good flash for him to get away from the other one here. But Bumble timer has come back up. And Scott says, thanks for the champion and thanks for the timing. Very close to timing out there.
Yeah, even gets the teleport for himself. EDD not showing a ton of expression to that happening. Then again, you probably just want to forget it and move on and hope for a better return into the game. Now, we're going to come back onto the map where both junglers just chilling. I feel like for EDG, though, it's a lot about continuing to impact that mid and jungle matchup like we just saw.
Yeah, and both kills went over to Scout. This has huge, huge effects on this early game here. I mean, EDG, they put down a flag in Champ Select. We're stealing away your Zoe, BDD. We're stealing away, or we're picking the Kennen, which we have not picked at Worlds, and we are 0-3 with this year. And they've got two kills on that steal away pick for Scout, so a lot of it in his hands. Double buff in addition to it.
Finds another bubble as well, getting some good damage on, again, a champion that he did not play in the summer split of LPL. In a composition where, frankly, I feel like the longer this game goes, it will be much harder for EDG. There will be opportunities, like we talked about, things like Kennen flanks and these burst opportunities, but EDG definitely being the composition that needs to get ahead early, and I like that we see Scout kind of hovering towards the bottom side, looking to utilize Fog of War, though Gen.G do have Scuttlecrab on that side, so it doesn't do too much.
Decent shot into life, good hits there to 200 HP, bubble not quite gonna land, but a little bit more poke as Jiejie could come around. Level 4 to level 5 on the Viego, but of course no TPs and no one's around on the side. This could be a possible dive. That ward's gonna be spotted and killed, and Gen.G gonna have to give up this wave.
Yeah, they're gonna have to give up a lot here because Scout also pushed mid lane, and BDD, since he tried to teleport out of the skirmish at Raptors, doesn't have his teleport, so Scout gets a comeback down there supporting this attempt at the steal away on the Gromp, does get the smite, and the turret plate is going to be mined away. Now they can reset. You see, you just play off your pressure from your minion wave towards mid. That one bounces back as BDD slowly pushes it out, and Scout can return.
I think a critical thing about this game as well is when you watch EDG in the regular season of LPL is...
That was nice.
Yeah, a bit of damage. A lot of EDG's early game jungle proximity was around mid lane. It was all about Scout and Jiejie being like the early game anchor that did link up and then transferring that to sides of the map once we got to mid game or covering if dives were coming out per se on top lane. So nice to see this synergy coming back out in this game 4.
And that skirmish at Raptors on the first blood came down to one auto on the junglers being the difference in the health. Scout here kind of cosplaying the most interesting man in the world. I don't often play Zoe, but when I do, I like to start 2-0 with double buffs. We'll see what he can do with it. Again, the big moments here are really what make it. They've got to be able to snowball this one. It's such a large early game lead for them to be able to transition. Yes, it is a Cloud Drake, and they should be able to hand off blue and head over towards there. Now Zoe with blue and with the gold, plus having double summoners available, feels like they should be able to set it up.
Flandre playing aggressively in this lane, even though he is against the Vamp Scepter and Rascal has some sustain. It's Flandre ahead in the lane so far.
And again, we are about 36 seconds away from the Herald spawn. So the big commitment should come. When you have pushing bottom lane, it helps you. You have so many more options in these Herald setups because you can either push and go for the full rotation, bring your bottom lane up, or you go for the half rotation through the Fog of War. And then try and sneak back and not give up as many minions in the attempt. See if they actually go for it here, though. Clid trying to do the early sweeper work in preparation, and the bubble lands, but no follow-up.
Gonna take the recall. Jiejie finds the control that was put down. Gonna be spotted out. Just sidesteps Clid. Once again, the better on farm, already level 6. Graves on the move down as well. Could be a chance at a play, but just gonna turn right back around. Not too much to be had. Flandre waiting the brush. Could get some decent damage. Doesn't go for the ult play. Rascal able to E backwards and ult to stay alive, no problem. BDD jumps the wall to get away as well. Jiejie with a control ward gets to take ownership of this side of the map.
We are finally starting to see that rotation that Kobe was talking about, though, waiting for a couple more waves to start the rotation. Viper and Meiko making their way up. And with the early game spike that Scout does have, having the lost chapter now, I would definitely favor EDG in this sort of situation. You're going to see now Scout playing with terrain just in case the members of Gen.G do approach.
All right, the attacks are on, down to 2,600. A small smite's available. Clid has the big one, but it's gonna be pushed down too quickly. The bot lane's here just in case. No play.
Gen.G committed to the trail, even though their bottom lane was the one without priority. Usually, you'll see them just opt to pushing out the extra wave, you know, so the AD carry at least gets another wave of experience, gold there, try and chip away at a tower plate, but Gen.G actually rotated also in answer in trailing Ruler in life, so they don't get anything out of there, and that's big
aggressive.
For EDG.
Gonna be stunned, gonna be locked up, this is so much damage, the ult comes in, the flash followed through with the Heartbreaker, and Clid is on the board.
Yeah, really nice play. play coming out from Gen.G. Maybe Flandre assuming that Clid would want to make his way towards bot side, but the fact that their bot lane was late on the rotation, trying to get some vision down for Dragon, but instead does commit to getting this in top, and Rascal as well, not only denying minions, but getting another plate of gold. Actually, his first plate of gold.
Still more than zero, so I'll take it as a plus one. And now Tidal Wave coming across, big damage. The bubble's gonna land as well. BDD, he's ignited, he's got a shield, and he's just gonna drop Scouts on for three.
Scout steals away one of his champions, and he's stealing away his life here. Three kills on the Zoe for Scout now. Bounty on his head. They're the ones that get to play the setup game with the Zoe. Extra vision already achieved.
Oh, Meiko.
That was definitely a brush with death there. Bold to go solo as the Lulu getting some vision, but because EDG are so focused on utilizing their Rift Herald and getting paid here, they're going to be able to make it happen.
Not quicker to finish the turret, but it will get all the way to four plates claimed, three of them shared between Jiejie and Scout. The TP force out of BDD means not a lot of control for bot lane. Thankfully, Bullet Time can do that work for you, and Ruler keeps up in the lane.
I can't even imagine the gold lead that Scout has right now. Probably able to back and just look for a mythic item purchase after the last kill, as well as these plates coming out. Not going to be able to, though. Sadly, doesn't even have TP. Going to have to wait for either Jiejie to come cover, or if Gen.G just committed this play, maybe he can find a window to where he can get that reset off, because he has no mana right now. So I don't think EDG should look to contest this, but they are.
Without Scout, that'd be crazy. You cannot poke around there. Scout is recalling. No teleport on Zoe. Yeah. I agree with you, I concur.
I don't think it'd be the craziest thing we've seen in this series, so I'm not gonna put it against them for doing it, but yeah, nice to see that EDG did decide to back off. Already do have a 2K gold lead at 10 minutes, but again, to me, it's just continuously coming out from mid jungle. I don't even feel like you necessarily need to commit ganks. BDD as well, having flash up now. Even with Jiejie just hovering towards mid, you can go for plays like we saw earlier, where Scout's moving down the river, and at least just zoning their bot lane off from the turret.
CS lead is 8 down to the bottom lane, though, and they are just constantly playing aggressively. Viper going to go ahead and take this wave right away. It'll give him a very aggressive recall timing that happens, thanks to the assist. We've got the Gore Drinker done. And even though Clid has been out farming Jiejie, he's got enough gold that he's able to get his Mythic online. First of this game, but not in time to play for the Dragon. So Gen.G, they're weathering a 2,500 gold deficit, and that's going to grow. They've at least got their first dragon, but because he showed, he's like, all right, I'm around. Once again, Ruler and Life have to fall off the wave, and plate number three will go to Viper and Meiko.
Yeah, this Lucian Nami doing a lot of damage once again, and Viper's going to be that big threat. A lot is hinged on his positioning and his movement. In some of the games, when he's going so aggressively, you know, chunking people out before objectives, it actually earns them a huge amount for the setup. But again, then you have the ones where picked off, it's turned around in on him. I will say, at least for this time around, it's more difficult for Gen.G to really punish aggressive movement because it has to be a surprise play from BDD.
There's the swoop on back, flashing back over, will not be stunned up by Viego, but he's gonna go to sleep. Are they gonna go for this play? Jiejie would have every cooldown, but they don't want to go for the push. Maybe they could have, but not gonna happen.
Yeah, still nice for them to be able to punish the flash coming out from Scout. They need to find these ways back into the game somehow, especially when Kobe's just talking about the aggression coming out from EDG's bot lane and how hard it is for Gen.G to punish. Nice to see BDD set something up once again.
Yeah, let's see, because Scout does have the bounty on his head as well for the extra money. Now doesn't have flash. With the summoner spellbook, moves over to Ghost. Maybe we'll be able to use the extra speed to remain safe and not let the follow-up play here from Gen.G actually find purchase. But again, because of the setup here from Gen.G, they're so DPS oriented and don't have a lot of those big moments. Since BDD just used the ultimate, kind of got to wait on some cooldowns here.
I feel like for Gen.G, you do have one play available to where, I highlighted for EDG, right? You can hover mid-jungle down to bot. For Gen.G, they at least do have TP advantage up in the top lane. So as long as you can have BDD like hovering down towards bot to match either roam or a TP from Scout, you can try and set up a numbers advantage play. The only hard thing is that Viper and Meiko are hard shoving the wave. So for Ruler and Life to be able to get a deep board for a flank to come out from Rascal would be quite hard.
Yeah, also, the flank is very, very improbable. Being able to set up at... Okay, never mind. Bottom thing is going to just be some more harassment from the ultimate. Ooh, and bubble almost. Not landing means they won't actually find any purchase.
But getting a bit of damage done. Plates have finally dropped, and it's a 2,400 gold lead to EDG. That's what I kind of call the early game over, and you move into mid game as you can't farm turrets for killing them outright anymore. And look at this, Jarvan's on the way over. Azir and Viego the one way first, an early TP. They're going for the quick dive. It's gonna be a bit of a 4v2. Ruler cannot get away with the Gale Force. The flash is out. Life flashes won't matter. And it's gonna be him dropping Scout once a bit more. I believe he lands the bubble, but it's not gonna get anything else done as they are gonna be back down to the turret. They're gonna knock down the first turret of the game. EDG aggressive in the bottom lane.
Really nice to see from EDG looking to make that play. Even on the top side, Flandre was following Rascal to make sure that he couldn't TP down there to follow up, and EDG are starting to open up the map.
Exactly, EDG beat them to the punch. They make the dive happen, taking down the outer turret, pushing it ahead. Bottom, or top side is the answer though, as it's just gonna be shoving him out and picking up Rift Herald.
He almost pretended like they were going for the gank. They're just getting the Herald instead. Theoretically, Flandre could have stole his ground, maybe, you know, ulted under the turret and cleared the whole thing out. But Rascal makes the aggressive play, knows he has the backup. It's going to be a longer fight. And that means it's going to be a turret traded and the second Herald going back over to Gen.G. So definitely fighting back, but a 3,000 gold lead to EDG off the early game.
Yeah, and overall, the trade can end up being about even, right? Because for now, it's two turrets to EDG for one for Gen.G. You would assume that Herald maybe can find some purchase raising a tower somewhere else. So Gen.G not falling too far behind necessarily, but where they did lose out is like Ruler and Life going down, at least Life dying in that exchange, losing out on minions and getting more XP and gold onto Viper.
And now with those two plays traded, and I think it's very intelligent for EDG to kind of force on the bottom side and then force those objectives to go down, weathering the storm and actually having that cooldown now for Flandre's teleport to come up and being able to match that critical one for top lane. Now it's a level 11 Kennen that is also going to have flash available for the big possible Kennen ultimates we are alluding to in Champ Select. And it's also going to be the dodge, actually, on the other foot here for Gen.G. They've done so well with mid lane tower down and them having the Zoe. Now it's EDG with the Zoe and them having all the opportunity to work with. They just want to stall here for Flandre to get as much damage on top side as he can. His teleport is ready, his flash is ready.
All right, but he's just autoing the turret right now, so what's the call going to be, EDG? If you keep playing this one, you can be outnumbered. You already are. It's 5v4, 2,000 health on the dragon. Smites have gone Clid's way, and they will yet again. He still doesn't miss. The TP comes in to take the fight. The dunk comes in. Clid won't find the kill just yet, and it's a swoop in. That's a one, but the slicing maelstrom turns it back. Three kills so far. Kennen gonna make it a fourth, and look at that. EDG get the team fight they want.
Exactly. EDG might not get the objective, but they get the kills. They continue to escalate this gold lead, JJ being the one to set it up, and Scout and Viper following through.
Five kills now for Scout's Zoe, stealing away the champion just when they need it. Game four here, looking to push it to game number five. Still, Clid has been so good with these timings on the smite, but look at the engage. JJ goes in, flash ultimate. They're able to land it. Scout backs up for the bubble onto BDD, so even though he gets his ulti off, and then Flandre, that Kennen ultimate on all those squishy targets.
Yeah, really nice patience coming out for him. I do want to say in this fight, I was a bit scared that BDD wasn't going to be punished for being about 10% HP. Thank God Scout Portal jumped in there and finished him off. And now we're at 5k gold lead. I feel like despite the fact that a lot of people know these teams as like slower paced teams, especially in regards to the regions they play in, again, we see that later on in the game. Both of these teams are going to be aggressive, go toe-to-toe in the first 15 minutes, as we've seen a large gold lead almost every game.
Pushing for more. Waiting now, of course, 2 minutes till the Baron comes up. Dragon Soul can always be a concern since Gen.G got the first two, and reasonably early on into this one would be well sub 30 minutes if they were able to get the next ones up. Ocean Soul, definitely not a bad look when you're trying to weather some poke. Rascal feels pretty good here up against Flandre. Merc Treads are done, stacking in the lifesteal, gonna be Bloodthirster second, and that can be tough to deal with. JJ gonna bring in the reinforcements though, and top lane outer is to die. Flandre did the first part of the work, and Scout's gonna do the rest.
EDG with a really nice two lane setup so far, just hovering through mid, going up to top side. Now, once Scout gets his turret, he can even make his way back down, trying to put bubbles over those walls that are on mid lane if Ruler and Life step up, and kind of put this push and pull between both top and mid. Gen.G potentially could have tried to answer top bottom lane earlier on, but feeling too much pressure coming out from the long range and siege from the Zoe. So Clid, though, is in a bit of a spicy position.
It'll almost kill, but as long as the reinforcements show up, they can do the rest of the damage. Bot lane already getting attacked and killed. Rascal gonna claim that turret, making the score 2-3, and the mid lane crash at least gets something done. I think he had more time, but he gets the damage in, at least that's something, and the turret's gonna be low in mid.
Yeah, I think he knew it's going to be difficult for them to actually regain control of the map since Gen.G, since EDG made such a big push with these deep wards on top side and pushing in and split pushing. So just wanted to get the activation while he could secure damage on the tower. Maybe they can return to it at a later date. They did at least get Rascal's push in. They've really struggled to make use of that, you know, teleport advantage for Rascal, though, when they've had it with the Graves. Not necessarily,
instead of, like, 10 minutes.
It's, like, not necessarily a very big flanking impact when you come in and can you, like, smoke screen sometimes can create some plays. But
you need the other team to overcommit, right? That's really the only way you can punish.
Yeah, and try and spread the map and make use of the tons of damage that this team does have packed in and try and push out the minion waves.
Now for Gen.G, it seems like they're kind of following the game plan of EDG from last time around, of just turtling in their own base, not overcommitting too much. And heck, even lucky for them, they're the team with two dragons. So EDG not on a front where they're going to be able to pull them out, but Rift Herald, actually not Rift Herald, Baron is spawning.
Yeah, and again, this time around, EDG feels so confident. They've got the Zoe, 5 kills, 2 item power spikes, 7 stacks on the Dark Seal, 4 Scout, fully warded up jungle. It is just a dream scenario to play this champion. So dangerous for Gen.G. Thank you, Observers, for toggling Fog of War. So much of this series, we've been like, oh, how scary is it to play against BDD Zoe with no vision coverage and objective up? Well, guess what? You get a taste of your own medicine here as EDG pushing on top side. The counter, though, to go capitalize on that early Rift Herald.
And can they be attacked, though? Flandre, of course, is here. Rocket Belt is done. Going to be second item Void Staff. Will certainly be lethal, and they're not going to stick around for the turret as the rest of EDG were walking down. A lot of this is fog. They can't see all the moves. Rascal going to be able to sidestep the bubble. No sleep for him, and just lifesteals all the way back up as he's got Shield Bow plus the Vamp Scepter.
All right, now we're going to be looking at the Dragon setup coming out for both teams. EDG should be able to get members down there first from the fact that Rascal is pushing out this top side. He does have TP. Clid should be fine.
Yep, Blast Blunt is there. Rocket Belt burned. It's going to be down for the eventual dragon fight, and Clid just has not been kept out of these pits. I feel like EDG have to take a hard stance at fighting, because if they're going to lose the dragon if they don't, you know, kill Clid before it's low.
Ooh, maybe. Nope, no bubble connecting from Scowl, but Gen.G, again, they're going to need to mark the flank. They need to watch out for Flandre, who does have flash up, so doesn't even necessarily need to find the flank. Can go straight into Gen.G.
Wait for the Rocket Belt. It's still going to be on cooldown for now. Starting the auto attacks, but they're inside the brush with a control within it, so there's no vision on the Gen.G side. Scout coming down on his own ward, though. He's going to push Gen.G back a little bit. Bubble's not going to land. Once again, aggroed onto the dragon. 5,000 health. Clid waiting on the left-hand side. BD trying to find his opponent. Scout going to look for poke. Not going to get it just yet. Bubble may have landed onto the Graves, but Clid's still waiting. Clid's landed every smite in this series. Clid's going to try again, and Clid's going to get it again. Once again, and it's soul point for Gen.G. EDG cannot even team fight with a gold lead. BDD goes in, and so does Flandre. 2-for-1 so far. Rascal low. Clid should drop. Cannot get the reset. Ascendant to Rascal. 3 alive versus 2, but 1 kill for soul point feels Gen.G favored until they get this one. That kill's gonna go through to EDG. Plus 2 on the team fight, but you have to take control or you lose the Dragon Soul.
Exactly. EDG, I think, need to turn for Baron. They need to get something for this. We do see pings coming out on the Baron now. And if EDG can get that objective, they can try to tangibly turn this into enough map control to end the game.
Yeah, definitely a big chase down kill for EDG. It's going to be up to Ruler and Life to hold the line. I think with the recalls or the revivals coming up for the rest of the members, it'll be fine for them. They can just wait it out until the next dragon. But Lyric, I thought that Gen.G, as soon as they got that steal and you saw the backup from EDG, they were going to just take the W, take the steal, and back out. But then they go all in and they engage for it. So Clid, another huge smite, even forces JJ out of the pit with the flash. And then the opening here, and BDD just goes right for it. But good dodge there from Viper.
Yeah, I think that's so weird coming out. I think even Clid initially going in with the Viego makes sense, but following up with BDD, like you are at soul point, Kobe. That's all you needed.
Exactly. Take the W that you just got. You just stole the dragon with the smite. You know that the counter engage is so much more fearsome with Kennen ultimate. So when you're calculating all the big ultimates on your side, taking into account what the counter is going to look like, and when Flandre gets to sweep in, much squishier there for BDD.
I also feel like now EDG are at the point where they're probably going to have to look to start baiting Barons. Because even if you do continuously get good setups for dragons, right, there's still always at least going to be some sort of variance or RNG of Clid getting in there and winning the smite, which he's done consistently. The good thing for EDG, if they are willing to be more aggressive in baiting a Baron, is their composition actually does have good turn potential with things like the Jarvan or the Nami ultimate.
And any extra time they have for Scout to throw bubbles is going to be a good time for EDG. He's got 17 stacks in his Medjays after those last kills at the dragon fight.
So when's the play going to happen? When does the Baron bait truly begin? Right now they're just kind of fighting back and forth over vision. Viper did a lot of damage in that last fight. Flandre put in 3k, but Viper did even more. He has been a huge deal once again on the same build of Rapid Fire Cannon third, allowing him to play aggressively and look for almost picks in the mid game.
Ooh. EDG now even do have wards set up to where if they did want to try and bait them into this vision, like they're trying to do now, Flandre would have a really good angle to come from. But Gen.G just aren't biting.
Down goes the ward, and not going to be any poke just yet. But once again, as you play for this, you take the midway first. You make sure they can't counter your turrets. Looking for the play. They might find the sleep. They might find a knockup on a two. Into the canyon they go. And Clid able to jump over the wall. But this could be it for the Kennen. Able to force a couple of flashes out. A stun and almost dead. Sidestepping it. But BDD finds the long range shot. Zoe not required. It's Gen.G who win this fight.
And EDG are just getting so ahead of themselves looking for this play. Again, you could tell that they want Gen.G to walk in, but Gen.G are just playing it well. They realize, hey, we don't need to walk in. We're fine. You're going to come into us, and they find the kill.
Every EDG fan is pulling their hair out right now, Lyric. So close, and yet so far, they make the chase into the fog of war. Kennen gets burned down, and Gen.G are able to stabilize.
I think the strangest thing is, right, they're showing that they're not willing to go on the Baron and try and, like, risk that, but they're willing to go for the risk of this play of just running headfirst into Gen.G. It starts off looking pretty well, with Gen.G getting a multi-man knockup, the calling does get BDD down quite low, but now they just have no way to continue following up. Flandre, going a bit too far, doesn't have Flash to try and follow them over the wall to maybe take down Clid and BDD, and just get chunked so low by both Rascal and Ruler.
Yeah, if the Nami wave was a little bit to the side, the Graves ultimate also a little bit to the side. They still got the kill, though. Again, this series, you cannot count anybody out, okay?
Nope.
Yeah, it definitely feels like maybe the teams with advantages have maybe been the ones that you can't completely rely on when things happen.
The one thing I can rely on, though, is Clid Smite, and this is Ocean Soul in 30 seconds. A 5,000 gold lead dictates that EDG should have complete control, and yet they never find a way to keep Clid out of the pit. Right now, they try to own the bottom river. They can spot roughly where Viego is. They see him on the wave. They know what's going on. Maybe they take the fight, but bullet time is available. Make it rain slows them down. Gen.G gonna play in these brushes. They've got control wards in most of them. EDG had the dragon spawning in 1 second. Will they find a team fight is the question. It's Viper coming in, taking some damage, a really good culling. Rascal could be a target. Asleep on a Clid, not going to mean much, but Rulu's at half. Jiejie doesn't find the engage. He's going to find his own death, a flash to safety. And now Rascal wants in for a bit more. Has an ult. The flash means nothing. Takes a bubble, but the health bars are at half. EDG could have to burn down this Drake. And Gen.G may just go for the bot side. Flandre going to stay in the brush. Going to find his ulti to zone out Clid and force him to jump over the wall. They might find this kill, but they might find Kennen dying. It's going to be a dragon picked up. It's Scout getting the sleep, getting the first kill. And they might, they should, and they do get Ruler. The dunk onto life, 3-0.
They've done it! EDG have done it! They finally marked Clid! They got him! They're chasing down all of the kills!
And BDD is at 15%! He's gonna get blasted and he's gonna die! Rascal left alone! EDG win the team fight. Baron has to be their prize!
Exactly. EDG just need to keep going forward. They're impatient. It looked dicey, but they got the dragon because Flandre waited in that tri-brush. He makes sure Clid couldn't get into the pit. And now EDG are finally taking everything after a rocky past few minutes.
Oh, should be big rewards now. The pressure mounting for so long on that one with the setup, you know, so many big chunks in health. Flash used to try and re-engage and trying to keep the Kennen out, but in the end, Flandre got the last laugh.
And Scout got a lot of the early poke as well. I mean, Ruler started that fight at half. You know, BDD got quite low as well. It's a 25 stack Medjays for the mid laner. Let's watch this win again.
And we see Flandre being the one to mark Clid here in the brush. Does get so much damage down on him, keeping him out of the pit while the other EDG members follow up. Even does flashback in to try to keep him down. Then Scout over the side, Paddle Star, Sleepy Trouble Bubble. Everything's hitting today for Scout. And then EDG knowing they can just continuously follow up with all the damage. And man, this game has just kept us on the edge of our seats. It feels like anything can happen at any time.
That's just really nice. I mean, Scout, he got a little bit out of, I believe it was Meiko, but realistically, solo kill BDD while at half health to start. There's your 5,500 damage for Scout. Yes, indeed. Second longest standing member on the team. Pretty much his entire career has been on EDG. And he's going for his first world final. They got to win two straight to do it at this point, but they are so well poised to take game four.
Yeah, the LPL lives on. EDG aren't quite done with this series yet. Baron buff will be able to get topside turret for sure. Inhibitor now going to be exposed. And Gen.G trying to clear out the wave, push them out, but it's going to be so difficult. Again, engaging into it. Got Kennen ultimate level 16 there for Flandre. Proto Belt used.
BDD has dropped low enough that there's no team fight for Gen.G. A 10,000 gold lead. The Red Bull Baron power play at 2,700. EDG likely to claim mid here as well.
EDG now just going to rotate, play the map, right? They have a mid wave pushing. Just push that one in. Keep utilizing your siege with the Zoe bubbles over the wall. Maybe look for an angle if Flandre can find a way in. If Gen.G try to stop your siege and look for an engage. And just buy the book so far for EDG.
How much weapon do you have? BDD at half health again. Rapid Fire Cannon Lucian with an Nami buff. Pretty decent damage on the double shot. And once again, he's going to be forced back to heal. No, he's got to stay around. It's bullet time to clear. Asleep on Lulu will not get them a kill, but it's still going to create some space. The turret at about half HP. That's another sleep on the Lulu, but Scout's out of cooldowns. Tidal wave to try to push them off. They've got just the cannon. Not going to mean a whole lot here.
Cannon buffed up still. Gonna have another 30 seconds. One extra wave comes down mid lane. This will be the last one before the Baron buff does fire.
That is damage. Thank you very much. Kennen and Scout come together. That's gonna be mid lane turret falling as well. And you don't really defend this 5v4. You give the inhibitor for sure. The question is, what else are you going to lose? All the way back in the fountain goes BDD. And it's time to go for the Nexus turrets. They've got double cannon. They got a whole wave. They got a 5v4. It's a jump in. Scout is legendary. Looking for the dive onto the Nexus turrets now. As Clid is low, Rassel trying to stay alive, and here comes the last final dive. Slicing Maelstrom cuts Gen.G to pieces. BDD tries his hardest, finds nothing. The ace comes through for Gen.G. We've had an exciting set of semifinals. We're going to game five. EDG in their first semi. They'd like it to be their first final as well.
Exactly. EDG keeping their hopes alive by bringing us the five games. Star-studded lineup. We've been looking for members like Viper and Scout to have the same performances that they had in the LPL here on the international stage. And this game, Kobe, they delivered.
Stealing away their champions, doing it. Oh, it just makes it so much sweeter, so much better. And looking forward to the champ select here in game number five now that they've been able to do that, now that they've shown some of these extra cards, also threatening the Kennen, which, you know, teams have not been respecting.